Hey everyone, today I'm going to talk about pathogenesis of psoriasis. If you're someone who starts hiding behind your friends when someone asks about the pathogenesis of psoriasis, this video is for you. First of all, I would suggest that you grab a pen and pencil and stay focused during this video so that you learn the pathogenesis of psoriasis for once and all. So let's get started. If you're visiting my channel for the first time, my name is Dr. Namra Aziz, resident dermatology. I make a lot of educational content. If you haven't subscribed my channel, please click the subscribe button and the bell icon to get notifications. You can also follow me on Instagram at Dr. Namra Aziz. Let me share a little about the history of pathogenesis of psoriasis. For long, psoriasis was regarded as an epidermal disease in which fundamental defect resided within the keratinocytes. A major paradigm shift occurred when T-cell suppressive agents like cyclosporin were found to result in the dramatic improvement of psoriasis. After that, it became very clear that psoriasis is a T-cell driven disease. There are four major components of the pathogenesis of psoriasis: dysregulation of innate immune system, dysregulation of adaptive immune system, dysregulation of keratinocytes. Keratinocytes basically form a part of innate immune system, but I have written them separately over here just to add another point about keratinocytes. There are some vascular changes as well. In addition to these four, chemokines and cytokines also play an important role in the pathogenesis of psoriasis. I will keep on notifying throughout the presentation components of the innate and adaptive immunity. First of all, it's important to know that which cells are present in the innate immunity and which cells are present in the adaptive immunity. It's a very basic concept and most of you already know this, but I would like to emphasize it here so that there is a clear understanding of the pathogenesis. Cells of the innate immunity are dendritic cells, macrophages, natural killer cells, neutrophils, and keratinocytes. Cells of adaptive immunity are CD4 positive T cells and their subsets, which I'll be discussing later in the pathogenesis, CD8 positive cells and regulatory cells. Now let's start with an actual stuff. The disease process starts in epidermis. Due to an unknown trigger, stressed keratinocytes release DNA and RNA, which binds with the antimicrobial peptide. The antimicrobial peptide in the psoriatic patients is gethlisidin-337. These antimicrobial peptides are basically a part of the defense system. These antimicrobial peptides, along with the DNA and RNA, activate the plasmacytoid dendritic cells. We all know what are dendritic cells. Dendritic cells are antigen-presenting cells, which means that they present antigen to the T cells. But what are plasmacytoid dendritic cells? Well, these are specialized type of dendritic cells which are largely absent in the normal skin but are present in the psoriatic skin in very large amount. Plasmacytoid dendritic cells are very nasty and interfere with everyone. Hence, they produce interferon alpha. It's an easy way to remember that interferon alpha is produced by plasmacytoid dendritic cells. This interferon alpha then acts on dendritic cells. These are the myeloid dendritic cells which are already resident of the dermal skin. If you want to know the origin of myeloid dendritic cells, see my video on histiocytosis. In the initial part, I have explained about the antigen presenting cells. Another important point that I would like to mention here is that dermal dendritic cells are very plastic. They change into different forms. In psoriatic skin lesions, they change into inflammatory dendritic cells, which produce a lot of pro-inflammatory cytokines. I'll discuss them later. It's important to note that antimicrobial peptides are found in the epidermis and all of these dendritic cells are present in the dermis. When keratinocytes see all of this, they don't like the interference and they are used to being number one and they take out all their golf tees and start hitting sixes with them. It's an easy way to remember. Number one, interleukin 1. From golf tees, you can remember TNF-alpha and from sixes, you can remember interleukin 6. So interleukin 1b, TNF-alpha and interleukin-6 are the interleukins which are secreted by the keratinocytes. These interleukins also affect dermal dendritic cells. So what will happen next? These myeloid dendritic cells will go to the lymph node and present the antigen to the naive T cells. It's important to remember that there are two interleukins produced by the dendritic cells, interleukin-12 and interleukin-23. These are easy to remember, so I didn't make any mnemonic for them. Interleukin 23 is a very, very important interleukin in the pathogenesis as well as treatment of psoriasis. Under the influence of these interleukins, naive T cells differentiate into three subtypes: T helper type 1, T helper type 17, and T helper type 22. It is specifically the interleukin 12 which results in the differentiation of T helper type 1 cells from the naive T cells, and interleukin 23 causes the differentiation of naive T cells into T helper 17 type. It's important to remember that the major response in the pathogenesis of psoriasis is T helper type 1. But wait a second, isn't this a normal process that an antigen comes and then attacks on the antigen presenting cells which then present the antigen to the lymph node? No. It is way, way far than a normal process. First of all, like I mentioned, there are specialized kind of cells called as the plasmacytoid cells. Secondly, the myeloid dendritic cells are dramatically increased in the psoriatic skin. Third, it's an ongoing process that keeps on happening again and again, and regulatory cells cannot control it. These cells will then migrate from the lymph node through the lymphatics into the bloodstream and back to the skin, where they will form the psoriatic plaques. Now, which part of the skin they go to depends upon the chemokines which are secreted by the skin to attract them. Okay, now what will these three cells do? Out of all of these, TH1 cells do not like the nasty plasmacytoid cells. Hence, they take the GOF-Ts from the keratinocytes and produce interferon of their own, interferon gamma. If you can learn this without a mnemonic, you're good to go. These interleukins, interferon gamma and TNF-alpha, further act on the dendritic cells as well as on the keratinocytes and ask them to produce more inflammatory cytokines so that the inflammatory cascade goes on. So the main role of TH1 cell cytokine is the maintenance of the inflammatory cascade. TH17 cells are also very, very important. They produce interleukin 17A, interleukin 17F, and also interleukin 22 and interferon gamma. An easy way to remember interleukin 22 and interferon gamma would be that they take one interleukin from the each of the neighboring cell. Interleukin 22 from TH22 cell, interferon gamma from the TH1 cell. This is only for remembering it. Okay. Now these interleukins will act on the keratinocytes and will increase keratinocyte proliferation. We all know how fast keratinocyte proliferation is in psoriasis. These interleukins, which are secreted by TH17 cells, also recruit neutrophils to the epidermis. We all know how important neutrophils are in the histopathology of psoriasis, but in the pathogenesis they are only contributory and are not the main cells like the T cells. Helper 22 cells only produce interleukin 22, and the role of interleukin 22 is not very clear in the psoriatic lesions. For now, we only know that they also maintain the inflammatory process. Now, some other cells of innate and adaptive immunity which have a role in pathogenesis of psoriasis, but we don't know where and how. First of all, CD8 positive T cells. Up till now, we discussed CD4 positive T cells and their subsets. CD8 positive T cells bind to the collagen 4 in the basement membrane of the epidermis in the psoriatic lesions and migrate into the epidermis. How do they contribute to the pathogenesis by being in the epidermis? We don't know. But all we know is that CD8 positive T cells are found abundantly in the epidermis of the psoriatic lesion, and CD4 positive and CD8 positive T cells are found in the dermis. Next would be macrophages. They are part of an innate immune system. They are also present in the psoriatic skin lesions, but we don't know how do they exactly contribute to the pathogenesis. Next would be natural killer cells. They secrete interferon gamma and TNF-alpha. It's very, very important to remember these because these are the same interleukins which are secreted by the TH1 cells. And these interleukins are very important in the pathogenesis of psoriasis, so we should know that natural killer cells also secrete them. Next would be inflammatory dendritic cells. Remember when I told you that the dendritic cells also transform into inflammatory dendritic cells in the psoriatic skin lesions? Well, these inflammatory cells also secrete interleukin 23, TNF-alpha and nitric oxide. Interleukin 23, like I have already mentioned, contributes to the activation of TH17 cells, TNF-alpha maintains the inflammatory cascade, and nitric oxide causes vasodilation.
let's talk about vascular changes. They're apart from the rest of the changes. Basically, the keratinocytes secrete vascular endothelial growth factor, basic fibroblast growth factor, and angiopoietin. Under the influence of these, there is angiogenesis.
It's important to note here that the nitric oxide secreted by the inflammatory dendritic cells causes vasodilation, and all of these cytokines cause angiogenesis. Vasodilation contributes to erythema, and angiogenesis contributes to the positive Auspitz sign. So the bottom line is, if you didn't get anything from the lecture, remember these things. Under the influence of an unknown trigger, stressed keratinocytes release DNA. The DNA then binds to the antimicrobial peptide called as cathelicidin 337, which then acts on the plasmacytoid dendritic cells, which secrete interferon alpha and act on the dermal dendritic cells, which under the influence of certain other cytokines from the keratinocytes go to the lymph node, present the antigen to the naive T cells, and they change into the three subtypes: T helper type 1, T helper type 17, and T helper type 22. T helper type 1 maintain the inflammatory cascade. T helper type 17 cause keratinocyte proliferation and recruitment of neutrophil. T helper 22 secrete interleukin 22, which also maintains the inflammatory cascade. Apart from this, there is also increased angiogenesis under the influence of certain cytokines secreted by the keratinocytes. These points are very, very important to remember. If I was asked what are the most important cytokines to remember, I would say TNF-alpha, interleukin-17 and interleukin-23. All of them also have biologics against them, so it's very, very important to remember that from where they are secreted and what are they doing. Thank you so much for watching my video. Don't forget to subscribe to my channel and hit the bell icon to get notifications. Follow me on Instagram at Dr. Namra Aziz. If there is any other topic you want me to cover, kindly comment below. Also, you can tell me if anything you did not understand from the lecture, I would try to explain it to you. See you soon with a new exciting video.